can, but
don't
just,
eat.
Yeah, don't eat. Let's put it on your neighbor.
All right, so you know, most of the suckers in the congregation, so look up the screens and follow up.
Okay.
Lots of smiles.
Because I have to review, I'll be reviewing all the footage. And there's nothing that speaks humility in your life like watching yourself on camera.
Hey, can we do like Dallas Cowboys cheerleaders when you put it on the big screen or something with all the other stuff?
Dallas Cowboys cheerleaders on the main screen?
So like the training kids and they pick their
clothes. Oh. I think it works.
Everything you can be seen on the big Megatron.
So see
church.
Is it a building?
With some pews?
A piano?
And stained glass?
Or is it something more?
2,000 years ago, the church was born.
It wasn't made up of the famous, the rich, or the powerful.
It was made up of everyday people who passionately believed in the message of Jesus.
It was the beginning of a revolution of love and freedom that would change the world forever.
In 369 AD, the church built the first hospital
as a place to care for those who cannot care for themselves. Today, the church is the largest single provider of healthcare in history.
The church was the first to stand up for the rights of children, creating the first and largest orphanage system in the world.
100 out of the first 110 universities in America
were founded as Christian institutions.
Places like Harvard,
Dartmouth,
Yale,
and Princeton.
Much of the world's greatest art,
architecture,
literature,
and music has been shaped by the church.
But the impact of the church isn't just ancient history.
Today, the church is stronger than ever
and continues to impact every corner of the world.
Over 300,000 churches in America
and almost 5 million churches around the world stand ready to be instruments of change, to do what governments could never do.
Every day, the church brings food and fresh water to millions of people across the world.
It has a renewed passion to help widows and orphans
and fights to free slaves in every part of the world.
It stands ready as a first responder on the scene to provide relief for victims of disaster.
The ripple of Jesus' impact can be clearly seen and felt in the church today.
And it's made up of people like me and you.
Today, you didn't just come to a building.
You came to a revolution 2,000 years in the making.
The world is facing as much trouble as ever.
But we are not afraid. We were created for such a time as this.
We will continue to do what we've always done.
Proclaim the message of Jesus.
To help a world that needs him so desperately.
Welcome.
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 Welcome to church.
Good morning. We're so happy you're here with us today. Please rise and stand and sing to the Lord with us.
Say that
4,000 tongues to sing my great Redeemer praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumphs of His grace. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad the honors of Thy name. Jesus, the name that calms my fears, that bids my sorrows cease. 'Tis music in the sinner's ears, 'tis life and health and peace. He breaks the power of canceled sin, He sets the prisoners free. His blood can make the foulest clean, His blood availed for me. Speaks with listening in His voice, new life the dead receive. The mortal broken hearts rejoice, the humble poor believe. Glory to God and praise and love be ever, ever given by saints below and saints above, the church and God in heaven.
Charles Spurgeon wrote, "Does not all nature around me praise God? And if I were silent, I should be the exception to the universe. Does not the thunder praise Him as it rolls like drums in the as the march of the God of the armies? Does not the mountains praise Him when the woods upon their summits write His name in letters of fire? Has not the whole earth a voice? And shall I, can I be silent?" Sing this with me, church.
But I see the works of your hands, the galaxy spinning, a heavenly dance, oh God, all that you are is so overwhelming. And I hear the sound of your voice, all at once it's a gentle and thundering noise, oh God. All that you are is so overwhelming. And I delight myself in you, captivated by your beauty. I'm overwhelmed by you. God, I know the power of your cross, forgiven and free, Lord, forever you'll be my God, and all that you've done is so overwhelming, and I delight myself in you, captivated by your beauty.
Rush into this place and speak to us today, Lord. We're gathered together to worship you in spirit and truth. We pray that you would be in all things this morning to work for your goodness and your glory as we stand in admiration and praise of you. Amen. If you'll turn to your neighbor, find someone you haven't said hello to yet this morning and shake their hand. Tell them you're glad to see them. Welcome to the church.
Well, good morning. My name is Darren Sides, and we are about to go into a period where we collect our offering. Before we do that, I have a few announcements, and I want to draw your attention to the first page of the worship guide that you were handed. This is our Welcome to Southside. This is our communication card. If you're a guest, I encourage you, please fill this out. But also, if you're a member and you have anything you want to communicate to us, prayer requests, needs, please fill that out as well. And I want to invite all of you to Wednesday night supper this Wednesday. And you can sign up for that easily through this card and just put it in the offering plate as it is about to be passed. The other thing I want to show you inside of this is the center page has all of our events. If you're ever wondering, hey, what goes on here? Well, we provide a nice little sheet to show you that. In the midst, my name is Darren Sides, and I am the Minister of Discipleship and Families here at Southside Baptist Church. And here at Southside, we believe that you should do three things to be an effective follower of Christ. You gather, as we are doing right now, in worshiping of God. I want to praise the band because that was great. Also, we grow. There was a grow group time right before this. If you ever want to be part of a grow group, I encourage it because we had great conversation in the one I was a part of today. And also, we believe that you go in service and in ministry. And in all those things, we do it all in Christ. So I'm going to pray and, as the ushers come forward, and we'll take up our offering. Dear Lord, right now we just know, God, that everything means nothing if it weren't for you. God, this would just be a random gathering that would have no power behind it, Lord, because the real power is you, and it's in you alone. So we pray right now as we give up these tithes and these offerings, Lord, that we just praise you in this, God, that we will be joyful givers, because we understand, Lord, that it's all yours to begin with. God, that everything is found in you, and everything will be given back to you, God, because you are the center of our worship. And we praise you for that, that you found favor on us even when we don't deserve it, and that you give us true freedom. We pray all these things in your name. Amen.
My name is Jessica Bellwood, and I am on staff with Youth for Christ Outreach for Deaf and Hard of Hearing Young People called Deaf Teen Quest. Deaf young people need Jesus just the same as hearing young people do. But they are often overlooked or ignored because of communication barriers. Isaiah 29:18 proclaims, "In that day, the deaf will hear the words read from a book." And we believe that the day Isaiah predicted is now, here, and everyone, in all languages, in every culture, including the deaf world. God is using Youth for Christ to reach the next generation of deaf young people with the good news of Jesus Christ. If you would like to learn more, please let us know. God bless you. We love you.
Good morning, Southside. My name is Gary Weber. I'm the pastor here at Southside, and I'm so glad you're with us today for worship. And I want to introduce to you my good friend, Bob Ayers. This is Bob. If you would give Bob a nice, warm Southside welcome. Bob, as you heard, saw in the video, is the National Director for Deaf Teen Quest. And I know many of you have already read a little bit about the ministry of Deaf Teen Quest. There was an insert in your bulletin this morning. And you're anxious to find the answers to the questions on the back. So, Bob, first of all, give us just a little bit. Tell us just a little bit about the ministry of Deaf Teen Quest and what you all are doing in the United States to minister to the deaf and hard of hearing.
It's an amazing God that we serve together. Who loves every young person and every language, and every people group around the world. But for the most part, the deaf community had been really overlooked by both the hearing community and then a lot of the deaf church didn't know and understand what to do in terms of interacting with teenagers. And so in 2000, my wife and I, we adopted a daughter who's deaf from South America. And when she became 14, she just couldn't understand the gospel. And so we started researching and looking around and saw that there were no national ministries that were reaching deaf teenagers. And so we planted Deaf Teen Quest and Youth for Christ and Young Life when we first initially started. And then over the next 8 years, it gravitated into Youth for Christ fully. But it's caring Christian adults willing to enter the world of lost, deaf, and hard of hearing teenagers and just bring the light and the truth and the grace of Jesus Christ into their lives. We collaborate with Young Life here at the School for the Deaf in St. Augustine. So we have to come together because the deaf are so scattered through mainstreaming primarily. So,
well, it's a little surprising if you were able to read in the video that if you were to gather up the deaf and hard of hearing, it would be the fifth largest country in the world. Folks may not be aware that the need is that great. First question on here, how many children are born with severe hearing loss compared to the general population? And it's one in every 300, 500, 1,000. How many is it?
It may surprise you, but it's one in every 1,000. So 1,000 hearing children are born, about one deaf is born. If you gathered all that up in America, that's around 80,000 deaf teenagers that are out there.
And not all of those children are born to deaf parents. And I think the question here is how many children are born to deaf parents?
It may be, I hope all these are surprising for you, but the about 1 of 10, about 10% is a generational deafness. Now, in deaf world, that's a very, very positive thing because these children develop at the same rate as hearing children with hearing parents because they have language from day one where their parents are communicating with them. And so developmentally, they're just right on track with their hearing peers. So, but it's only 10%. So 9 of those children are born to hearing parents.
And of those 9 children born to hearing parents, How many of those parents can sign fluently to be able to communicate as that child's developing language skills?
Yeah, probably maybe the most shocking statistic, and this is not to blame those parents. They love their children, but for several reasons, there's only one of those remaining nine who ever develop any kind of fluency in communicating in sign language. Normally it's the mother, so you have this absence of many fathers that can communicate with their children. So the remaining eight, they love their children, but as they develop and they get past sort of those basic home gestures in terms of go to your room or come here or whatever, as they go through the teen years, they can't communicate in their own family. So they don't, many of those natural supports that we depend on in hearing world are really absent.
And I know that the heart of your ministry, your heart, Kathy's heart, mm-hmm. is to minister and share the gospel with everyone. And of course, this being a group in particular where there are some various challenges that maybe the rest of us don't face in hearing the gospel, out of 100 deaf people, how many claim a personal relationship with Jesus Christ?
Because the problem really are the communication barriers. There's nothing wrong with being deaf. It does separate you from people, though, because of the communication barriers. As a result of all these things that I've been saying, the statistic that's often used is somewhere between 2-4% that claim a personal relationship with Jesus. Just because so few people have gotten through that cultural language barrier and gone into really to face all the challenges of the teen years, which is like hearing children with very few of those supports. So it's been a real crisis. Now here's the good news, okay? As it almost got extinguished out of the deaf community in terms of the Christian faith, there's a revival that's occurring because not only what DTQ has done, but we called together other organizations that anyone that loves Jesus and loves the deaf teenagers, what are we going to do about this in terms of reaching those deaf teenagers? So there's been a real revival, and now it's in the young adult age group. So you have people who've met in Deaf Teen Quest or some of these other ministries who fall in love, get married. Now we have the young deaf Christian family. So how are we going to support that in terms of really developing and healing the deaf community in terms of faith? We're not satisfied with 5%. Knowing Jesus. We think that everyone needs that opportunity to make an informed decision about following Christ.
Well, wonderful. Thank you so much for being with us today. And I also want to just let you know, many of you, it may be obvious on a weekly basis, that we do interpret our service here at Southside. And so if you are in relationship with someone who's deaf or hard of hearing, and they are able to communicate through sign, invite them to come to church with you here. And I also want to recognize our interpreters who do a great job every week of keeping up with those of us who speak really fast. I have to be mindful to slow down. So if you would you express your appreciation? I know we've got Allison and Cindy and Stacy. I don't know if Stacy's here today. So we want to say thanks for all the ministry you do, and thank you, Bob, for coming, making us aware of this. There's information here. If you want more information about Deaf Teen Quest, you can also visit their website and learn more about that and how you can be involved in that ministry as well. I've asked this morning for Bob to do our scripture reading, and Bob is going to sign the scripture reading, and I am going to interpret it for the hearing audience. Our scripture reading this morning is from John chapter 8, verses 30 through 47. If you are here this morning without a Bible, there's one in front of you. It can be found on page 821. And if you do not have a Bible at home, feel free to take that Bible with you at the end of service as our gift to you. The passage will also be on the screen. John chapter 8, verses 30 through 47. As he was saying these things, many believed in him. So Jesus said to the Jews who had believed him, "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." They answered him, "We are offspring of Abraham and have never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free?" Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever. The son remains forever. So if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed. I know that you are offspring of Abraham, yet you seek to kill me. And because my word finds no place in you, I speak of what I have seen with my father, and you do what you have heard from your father. They answered him, Abraham is our father. Jesus said to them, if you were Abraham's children, you would be doing the works of Abraham. But now you seek to kill me, a man who has told you the truth that I heard from God. This is not what Abraham did. You are doing the works your father did. They said to him, we are not born of sexual immorality. We have one father, God. Jesus said to them, if God were your father, you would love me. For I came from God, and I am here. I came not of my own accord, but he sent me. Why do you not understand what I say? It is because you cannot bear the word to hear my word. You are of your father, the devil, and your will is to do your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in truth because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks out of his own character, for he is a liar and the father of lies. But because I tell the truth, you do not believe me. Which one of you convicts me of sin? If I tell the truth, why do you not believe me? Whoever is of God hears the words of God. The reason why you do not hear them is that you are not of God. This is the word of the Lord.
Would you stand and sing this with us?
Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. You lift your eyes to heaven. There is freedom. Will you lift your eyes to heaven? There is freedom. Freedom reigns in this place. Freedom reigns in this place. Showers of mercy and grace falling on every face. There is freedom.
Freedom reigns.
Freedom reigns in this place. Showers of mercy and grace falling on every face. There is freedom.
The Spirit of the Lord.
Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom.
If you're tired, you're thirsty.
If you're tired and you are thirsty, there is freedom. If you're tired and you are thirsty, there is freedom. In this place, there is freedom. Freedom reigns in this place. 'Cause freedom reigns in this place. Showers of mercy and grace falling on every face. There is freedom. Freedom reigns in this place. Showers of mercy and grace falling on every face. There is freedom.
And we are truly grateful for the freedom that we can find in you, Lord, that we can gather in this place and know that your Spirit is here, because your word says where two or more have gathered, there you will be as well. So, Lord, we feel the sense of freedom that comes when we understand your truth. So we pray this morning as we open your word, as we study the words of Jesus, that you will reveal yourself to us, that you will reveal truth to us, and that we might be truly free. For we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. This morning, I want to begin a conversation that will last a few weeks. It's actually a conversation that we're also having on Wednesday nights in a series that we're calling The Lies We Tell Ourselves. And over the next few weeks, as we look at the end of John chapter 8 and the beginning of John chapter 9, we find in this passage some lies that Jesus' audience believed. And I think they're lies that we have a tendency to fall into believing as well. And I want to start this conversation and repeat for the next few weeks a very simple phrase. It's not original to me, but it's such a powerful truth that even if today you are here and maybe you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, I think this truth will be helpful for you as you maybe seek to understand more about God and how to maybe incorporate him in your life. And here's the simple statement. A lie believed as truth will affect you as if it were true. A lie believed as truth will affect you as if it were true. Would you just say that with me one time? Let's say it all together. A lie believed as truth will affect you as if it were true. To demonstrate this, or to give you an example, let me just share from my personal experience how this statement affected me one time. I think it affects me all the time, but one particular example is when I was in sixth grade going to seventh grade. It was a period of time where seventh grade was the beginning of what they called junior high school, and they were doing something. They were busing kids all over the city trying to fulfill the requirements of a desegregation order, and so there was a rumor going around my sixth grade class about the seventh grade center that I was going to go to, because somebody in the education system had the brilliant idea of putting all seventh graders together in one building. That's a brilliant idea. But I was going to go to this seventh grade center the next year, and the word on the street, on the sixth grade street, was that if you went to this school and you went into the boys' bathroom, you would get beat up. There were stories about how somebody's cousin had gone in and they had been knifed, and there were stories about how, you know, kids had been turned upside down and they'd been, you know what a swirly is, right? Yeah. You know by rumor, not by experience, I'm hoping, but either from giving or getting. But it was said that you would get a swirly if you ever walked in the boys' bathroom, that you'd be beat up, you'd be hurt, and so I just made the decision, seemed like a good decision, based on that information that I had been given, that I would just never go to the bathroom in seventh grade. And so so I know it's not a very brave response. I'm just being honest with you. We're in church. So I went to seventh grade. My entire seventh grade career, I never one time went to the bathroom for that entire school year. Now, here's the reality. That was a lie, but it affected me as if it were truth. Now, here's something else that was true. It never occurred to my seventh grade brain that I never saw any boy come out of the bathroom bloody or wet. But that didn't connect, so I just never went to the restroom that entire year. We believe lies all the time, and often we are telling ourselves lies. And nobody can lie to you better than you can lie to you. You are the best equipped person to lie to yourself and to believe it. And Jesus, in this passage, talks about the origin of all lies. He says in verse 44 of chapter 8 that when the devil lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies. That every lie finds its origin from the enemy. But in another passage, Jesus reveals an important truth for us. John 18, verse 37, Jesus said this: "For this purpose I was born, and for this purpose I have come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice." So if the enemy, if Satan, is the originator of lies, Jesus is saying, "I am the origin of all truth." In John chapter 14, verse 6, famous verse, he said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life, that no one comes to the Father except by me." So regardless of what we choose to believe or the lies we choose to tell ourselves, Jesus stands and says, "I am the truth." That the truth isn't just facts. The truth isn't just information. The truth is a person, and his name is Jesus Christ. And because of this claim of Jesus, Christians have always equated ultimate freedom, what it means to be free, with a pursuit and a knowledge of the truth. This is deeply embedded not just in the Christian teaching, but it has also become embedded in the fabric of our society, of the United States government. The very first amendment to the Constitution guarantees the freedom of speech and the freedom of religion, because the founders of our country understood that if there is no truth, there is no freedom, that the two go together. The church has been a catalyst for truth and freedom around the world from its very beginning. Not just in the origins of our government, you know, the pilgrims that came over trying to escape religious persecution, and they established the value of the freedom of religion, but even beyond that, if you look back in the late 1990s and the Eastern Europe, and as Eastern Europe began to break away from dictatorships and communist governments, it was the church that was at the root of that. It was the church that, even while it was underground, continued to proclaim and teach the truth. It's the reason so many of those governments sought to suppress the church and silence the church, because they understand that if people have truth, they will find freedom. This is going on in China today. The church in China is exploding with growth. And it creates a real problem for the government of China. It's happening in the Middle East, even as we speak, that as the church continues to be a champion for truth, shortly behind truth always comes freedom. And we've got to be careful as we consider our own situation here in the United States, and we enjoy the freedom even to come here and gather to worship today, that self-rule does not equal freedom. Actually, the gospel, the message of truth, the message that the church has been proclaiming for 2,000 years that has resulted in so much freedom, actually is the opposite. That Christians claim that it is the surrender of self-rule that leads to true and ultimate freedom. That's what Jesus is talking about in this passage that we read earlier. If you have a Bible, John chapter 8, verse 31, Jesus made this statement. It's a famous verse. Some of you may have it memorized. He said, "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." Now, Jesus is saying this in the middle of a long, ongoing conversation, argument really, that he is having with the religious leaders in the city of Jerusalem. And so they respond, these folks who've been arguing with him for several chapters now, as we have read through it, that they respond to him, "We are offspring of Abraham and have never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free?" Now, It's interesting, if you look at verse 32, we put that up on the screen, verse 32, and you see what they're claiming. What they're saying there is they're saying, we have never been enslaved to anyone. Isn't that interesting? Because it's historically not true. It's not accurate. The Jews actually found their beginning as a nation in slavery. They were enslaved to the Egyptians. And it was Moses. God led Moses to come back to deliver them. But even after they were established in their own country, it was only a few hundred years until once again they were conquered and they were taken into captivity and carried into exile. And even as these Pharisees are saying this to Jesus, they are under the occupation of the Roman government. They're under the authority of Rome even as they're making this statement. So it's not historically accurate and true at all. But it's also spiritually untrue, Jesus says. Not only are you not free politically, but you're not free spiritually. Listen to what he said. He said, you are a slave to sin. Verse 24, Jesus said, Jesus answered them, truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. So you may think that you're free, but in fact, you're not. And if you want evidence that you're a slave to sin, you are even now trying to think up ways that you can kill me. You're being motivated, you're being driven by sin to do something that you would not otherwise do, to seek my arrest and my murder. Isn't it funny how our self-deception, when we lie to ourselves, it often finds its origins in something that we perceive we're good at. It often finds its beginning in something that we believe we already know we already have. You see, Jesus was engaged in this argument with these religious leaders. They were brilliant theologians. They had the Torah memorized, the first five books of the Bible entirely memorized. They were experts in the law. They could quote it to you. But in the midst of all their knowledge, everything that they thought they understood, they missed God. They missed the word of God. They missed the teachings of God. They didn't understand what it was that God was saying to them. And in fact, they missed the fact that God himself was standing in their midst. Part of the reason they missed it was because they were deluded with their own intelligence. They were deluded by their own spirituality. They were deluded by their own religious understanding. I wonder how many of us who gather here for worship every week think to ourselves, I got that. And we just check out. We just tune out because we think we already understand it. And so as we sit here in the pews, we think, well, I'm sure glad he's preaching this message because I know that person on the other side of the room really needs to hear what he's saying. Maybe somebody next to you. How many times do we fall into the very trap that the Pharisees fell into because we believe that we know more than we do? We take an area of perceived strength, and it actually opens us up to believe some very serious lies. They were in denial. These Pharisees were in denial about their true condition. They were in denial about their lack of understanding. They were lying to themselves specifically about freedom in two ways. And I want to spend the rest of our time today talking about these two lies that I believe the Pharisees had convinced themselves were true, because I think they may be the same lies that we believe are true. It may be the same way that we are lying to ourselves about freedom. So the first lie is this, that freedom is having no master. Tim Keller, the pastor of Redeemer Church, says actually freedom is having the right master. The lie is freedom means if I could have no master, if nobody were over me, then I would ultimately be free. The truth is freedom is having the right master. Do you know that whatever you live for is your master? So if you live for career and success and the work that you do, your decisions, your life will constantly be driven by how do you achieve greater success in your career? How do you accomplish more? If you live for the pursuit of money and the pursuit of wealth, then money and wealth are your master. And the decisions you make, the choices you decide upon, everything you do will be driven by the bottom line. How will this advance my pursuit of financial well-being, financial security? How will this give me more? And money becomes your master. Sex. If you're living for sexual pleasure, if you're driven by lust, you are a slave to sexual desire. If you're seeking approval from other people, maybe it's by trying to impress them with your knowledge. Maybe it's by trying to do something to serve them in a way that they'll finally give you their approval. All the different ways that you do it. And today in social media, don't we have a lot of ways to seek the approval of people? We do it all the time. But if you live for the approval of people, then seeking the approval of people will master you. Greed, everything that you are seeking becomes a master for you. The Pharisees wanted to believe that they were children of Abraham. That's the lie that they believed, that they were children of Abraham. But Jesus points out to them that they were, in fact, the children of the devil. Can you imagine? I mean, this is like Jesus is standing in the Vatican talking to the College of Cardinals around him. And he says to them, your father is not Abraham. It's Satan. I mean, it's remarkable that he even got out of this environment alive. And in fact, at the end of the chapter, you find that they tried to kill him, but he somehow managed to escape. It's a provocative statement. How does he justify it? He says, I know who your master is by what you do, by the choices you make. So the question for you today is, who is your master? And don't say, I don't have a master, because you do. It's impossible not to have a master. And if you want to know how to find out who your master is, I can give you two simple ways to check. And they're uncomfortable. You ready for this? Your calendar and your checkbook. Your calendar and your checkbook will reveal to you who your master is. How you spend your money and how you spend your time always reveals who your master is. And if you are here today and you're saying, well, okay, I get that, but I'm not sure I want Jesus to be my master. Just let me encourage you to understand this. Every other master is a tyrant. Every other master leaves you unfulfilled. If you're pursuing a career and success in a line of work, guess what will happen? Eventually, your career will bypass you. If you're seeking money, you will never have enough money. If you're seeking personal pleasure, you will never have enough pleasure. It will entice you, it will draw you in, but it will ultimately leave you unsatisfied and it will make you a slave. Jesus is the only master that ultimately leads us to freedom, which leads us to the second lie that the Pharisees believed about freedom, and I think it's one we struggle with too. And it's this: freedom is doing what you most want to do. If I could just do what I most want to do, then I'm free. The truth is that freedom is doing what you're meant to do. Let me give you an example. See, I want to be healthy. That's what I want. But I really like potato chips. And I really don't like the gym. So, in order to get the thing that I want, in order to have freedom in my health, I have to actually do the thing I don't want to do. Right? I have to eat right. I have to exercise. I don't want to do either of those things. But if I want to be free physically, I have to do the thing I don't want to do. This is a lie that we are told and we believe all the time. That freedom is doing what you want to do. And the message of the gospel is no. Freedom is doing what you are meant to do. See, we want to believe that freedom is always doing what you want, where you want, when you want, how you want, with whomever you want. But this belief and the pursuit of that kind of freedom leads you to become a slave of your impulses. This is why Jesus said that whoever sins is a slave to sin. This is at the very heart of addictive behavior, that you continue to produce something that's destructive for you in the name of freedom. And a slave is always insecure. Jesus is talking to the Pharisees about the fact that they don't know what the future holds for them. But someone who's been set free, someone who's been adopted, is secure in their future. Galatians chapter 4, verse 7 says, "You are no longer a slave, but you are sons and daughters. And because you're sons and daughters, you are heirs of God." You know what that means? You're heirs of God. Your future is secure. When you're a slave to sin, you are constantly living under the bondage of guilt, of a guilty conscience, and it's inescapable. It's interesting, some studies have been done of people who claim to be atheists or agnostic. They do not believe the Bible has any authority for their life at all. And when they're completely honest and truthful, even when they engage in behavior that the Bible would say is sinful behavior, they still struggle with guilt. Because there's something hardwired inside of us. There's some message that I believe comes from our Creator that says you're living against the way I've designed you to live, and I'm trying to put pressure on you not to keep you from being free, but to set you free from the bondage of sin and slavery that you're struggling with. Jesus said that the freedom that he offers is the assurance that you will not be a slave, but in fact you will be a son. And listen, it's not the impulse itself, that inner desire that you have, that you struggle with, that is sin. For example, there's nothing sinful about food. There's nothing sinful about sex. God created both of those things, and I'm, for one, glad that he did. There's nothing sinful about money by itself. But how you use those things and how you respond to the impulses that are inside of you can result and lead to sin and bondage to sin. C.S. Lewis made an awesome analogy. He said, impulses and desires in this world are like keys on a piano. That there are no bad keys, there are no bad notes, but there are keys and there are notes that are played at improper times. That freedom comes when we know who the conductor is and what the score looks like. And when we can translate the score at the leadership of the conductor into beautiful music. And as a Christian, we believe that the Bible is God's score for life. And we believe that Jesus is the conductor. And our lives don't produce beautiful music because we all play what we want, when we want, how we want, with whomever we want. Our lives and our churches produce beautiful music when we play at the bidding of the conductor. We find freedom. So how do we stop believing the lies and begin to believe the truth? Well, if you go back and you look at verse 30 of chapter 8, you'll notice that Jesus was speaking to a group of people who had decided to believe in him. As Jesus has been engaged in this long argument, there are people in the crowd who have begun to believe in him. In other words, they came and they either had no opinion or maybe they had a negative opinion. But after hearing the debate that Jesus had been engaged in all through chapter 7 and into chapter 8, they're convinced and they believe in him. And so Jesus gives them a verse that is really important for us to understand and take apart. We read it already, verse 31. "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." Now, abide is not a word that we use a lot anymore. Some of your translations may use the word remain. But it's the idea of staying connected to, that there's a flow, there's a give and a take that's happening here. And Jesus said, if you will remain in me, that obedience, remaining in Jesus is a matter of discipline. It's like, to use another analogy from the piano, it's the discipline of practicing the piano brings the freedom to be able to make beautiful music. But what do I have to do? If I want the freedom to be able to sit down and play the piano, what do I have to do? I have to practice. I have to be disciplined. Jesus is saying, if you want the kind of freedom that I give, you have to be my disciple, the word discipline. How do you become my disciple? You remain connected to me. Don't believe the lie that tells you all that Jesus wants from you is a profession one time in your life. That if somehow I say the magic prayer, then I'm in good with God. That's a lie. Jesus doesn't want your profession. He wants your possession. He wants to be connected to you on an ongoing daily basis in order that he might work in you and work through you in order to set you free. Jesus is the master that we're all looking for. Jesus said in John chapter 14, verse 23, come and follow me. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. Some of you who have gathered here today, you may be living a lie. The lie that you're living tells you that you're free, and you can prove you're free because nobody tells you what to do, and you do what you want, when you want, how you want, where you want, with whomever you want. And you're living a life in which you're in fact a slave. And I don't have to condemn you. I don't have to criticize you. I don't have to even point out or make a list of sinful behaviors. Because here's what I know is true. You already feel that. Something inside of you is bowing up against the thing that's holding you captive, the thing that's holding you hostage. And you are drifting farther and farther away from God. And you may even be blaming God for the distance, when in fact it's you who's pulling away from Him. See, here's what you need to know. Just like the Pharisees, it is your pride that is holding you captive. It's the fact that you believe that you have a freedom that you do not have. And you are exercising your freedom by doing the very thing that is holding you captive. It's almost as if you were a slave on a slave ship. And you are content on that ship to roam anywhere you want. And you are free. You can go to any deck. You can go to the front of the ship. You can go to the back of the ship. You can go to the top. You can go to the bottom. That you can go anywhere you want, but you are still on a slave ship. And here's the question for you today. Do you want to be set free? Jesus said, if you abide, if you remain in me, then you're my disciple. And by being my disciple, by following after me, you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Today, the invitation is to be set free. For some of you, maybe that is by entering into a relationship with Jesus Christ. Maybe you've heard the teachings of Jesus. Maybe you come here week after week, and you've heard us talk about Jesus. You've heard this offer of freedom, but you've never taken Jesus up on it. For some of you, maybe you have made a profession of faith, but you're still the slave on the slave ship. You're not living in freedom. Today, the invitation is to stay behind Jesus, to understand the truth, and to be set free. We're going to sing a song in just a moment, and we're going to have a time of invitation. And the invitation is for anyone who would want to come. Maybe you just want to come and pray at these steps. Maybe you want to come and pray with me. But the offer is not just to come down front to the steps. That won't do anything. The offer is to be set free. Father, we come to you today, and we, first of all, are thankful. Thankful for the freedom that you offer us through the truth of your word. And Father, I pray that we would not believe the lies that we tell ourselves and that ultimately find their source in the enemy. Father, to somehow believe that if we can throw off every earthly master, we'll be free. If we can do whatever we want, we'll be free. Father, help us to give up our pursuit of self-rule, and instead live completely and totally surrendered to you. And in so doing, find the freedom that we're seeking. Father, I pray for the person who's here today who is struggling with the bondage of addiction to pornography. Lord, I pray that today they would know the truth and they'd be set free. Lord, I pray for the woman who, nobody knows it, but she's an alcoholic. She finds her escape in the bottle, or she finds her escape at the bottom of a bottle of prescription drugs. Lord, I pray that today she'd be set free. Lord, I pray for the relationship that's here and it's in bondage today, that the couple believes lies that the enemy is whispering, lies about each other, lies about their relationship. And they're living as if the lies are truth. Lord, would you be the truth in that marriage, and would you save it today? Would you set that marriage free? Father, for the teenager who's here today, who is believing the lie that they have no worth, that they have no value, that nobody cares, that nobody notices. Father, there's a lie being whispered in that teenager's ear. And Father, the temptation is to act upon that lie as if it were truth. Father, I pray that your truth would pierce their ears today and that they'd be set free. Father, for the person who's here today, who is satisfied with their relationship with you based on a profession of faith, but they do not live abiding in you day by day, would you open their eyes to see the reality of their circumstance? And Lord, for the person who's here today, who does not have a relationship with you, who has lived a lifetime as a slave, today, Lord, would you speak and whisper to them, invite them, Father. Invite them to be set free. Lord, we pray that you'll work in this time and that you'll make your spirit felt and known. In Jesus' name. Would you stand together as we sing?
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. T'was grace that taught my heart to hear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And
thank you for the freedom that we find in you. Lord, I pray this morning that even the invitation to freedom will stay in the hearts and minds and the ears of all of us who've gathered here. That, Lord, maybe we're addicted to the bondage. I pray you break that addiction to the bondage, whatever it is. And I pray that all across our city and really around our world, that men and women, boys and girls would be set free by your truth. For we ask it in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Good morning, and welcome to this week's Southside in 60. Are you the parent or loved one of a child in our Next Gen ministry? Following worship today, we will have a brief meeting to talk about our upcoming spring and summer schedules. Summer is almost here, and deposits for camp are due soon. Parents of children will meet in Kid Cove, and students will meet in the Student Center. For more information, see Christina Morse or Corey Weller. During Advent Conspiracy, we have brought in more than $40,000 for our Christmas offering. What an amazing opportunity we have all been given. If you have not had a chance to sponsor one of our local or international ministries, there is still time. You can find the form on our website where you can give someone the gift of a hot meal, a winter coat, a Bible, running water, and more this season. Join us Sunday, January 31st at 6 o'clock as we celebrate our great God and give thanks to the work he is doing through people of Southside. During this special evening, we will have the opportunity to ordain Scott Giddens. Make plans to stay after for a light reception. You won't want to miss this wonderful night. And there you have it, folks. Have a great week, seriously.
You look good on the picture up there. Good on the big screen. Yeah, even the setting looked especially good. Well, we're so glad. Hope you will join us on the 31st. And if you're here today and you have got someone that you love who's involved in elementary school, middle school, high school, we'd love for you to stick around and hear more about our summer activities going on with our Next Gen ministry. The children's department, just take the elevator to the second floor, and the students, you'll go to the third floor. So stick around and be a part of our Discovering Next Gen and hear about some of the activities this summer. We're so glad that you are here today. If you came this morning and you filled out your communication card, maybe you had a prayer request, maybe you wanted to sign up for dinner or one of the other activities, there are baskets right outside of the doors. If you didn't get a chance to put it in the offering plate as it came by, you can fold that up and drop that in the basket as you leave this morning, and we will certainly look forward to how we can partner with you in ministry in the coming week. I'm going to ask you to stand together as we have our benediction. My prayer is as you leave today that you will hear the words of Jesus and know that he has called you to freedom, and that you will hear his words, and by believing his truth, you will be set free. Those whom the Son has set free are free indeed. Grace and peace be with you.